Hi, Dr. Peterson. My question is, I know you stated in the last lecture that the importance for setting aims in life and to kind of have goals to work towards, right? So my question was, how do you do that if you don't know where you want to go? Because that's kind of where I got stuck on your future authoring program. Yeah. Because
Okay, that's a good question. That's a really good question. I think it's echoed to some degree in the structure of the biblical stories, and in this manner. So there's this notion in the Old Testament that morality is following a sequence of prohibitions. There's a bunch of bad things you shouldn't do, and then basically you're good enough. And I think there's wisdom in that. I think that's kind of where children start, right? I mean, I love children and all that, but they're crazy little creatures, and they need to be, you know, civilized. And partly what you do is you lay prohibitions on them, and mostly what you're trying to do is lay prohibitions on them for the behaviors that, if they manifested, would make their life miserable. So I have another chapter in this book that I'm writing called Don't Let Your Children Do Anything That Makes You Dislike Them. And the idea there is that your job as a parent is to help your children become the sort of four-year-olds that adults genuinely smile at when they come into a room, because that makes the entire social environment both truthful and welcoming. And so your job is to make them desirable social beings, and a lot of that is prohibition. Okay, and there's this ethical transformation. It happens to some degree in the tradition of the in the prophetic tradition, where there's a spirit that seemed in some sense to rise above the law. But there's a real transformation between the Old Testament and the New Testament, because the Old Testament is prohibition and the New Testament is, well, here's the good things you do once you're more than merely prohibiting yourself from impulsive sin, let's say. There's a positive good to be accomplished. Well, you might say, well, I don't know what the positive good is. Fair enough, man. So this is why this thing that I've said to people has become this crazy internet meme, but that's to clean up your room, and which is a lot better and more useful than people think. It's a lot harder, too. But the first thing you do, I think, and I learned this in part from Solzhenitsyn when he was trying to iron out his soul when he was in the gulag, because he was trying to figure out how he got there, how he contributed to how he got there. You know, not Stalin and Hitler, even though they were kind of to blame, you know, but there wasn't much he could do about that. I think what you have to do, and this is part of humility, is you have to look around you within your sphere of influence, like the direct sphere of influence, and fix the things that announce themselves as in need of repair. And those are often small things, you know, and they can be like your room. Put it in order, because the thing is, it isn't exactly so important that your room is in order, although it is. What's important is that you learn how to distinguish between chaos and order, and to be able to act in a manner that produces order. And in most households, there's 100 things that could be done to just make it less hideous and horrible. And so practicing that it's a real useful form of meditation. And it's also, I think it's a divine act, because you're taking chaos. And you know, if you pay attention even to a room, it's so interesting. And I learned, because I've renovated many places now and tried to make them beautiful. And one of the things that I've really learned is that even if you own a structure, unless you've investigated all the nooks and crannies and cleaned them up and put your own imprint on them and made them yours, they're not yours. The mere fact of physical ownership doesn't make them yours. You have to establish a dynamic relationship with the objects before they're actually yours. And I think you can do something as simple as just sit on your bed and think, okay, there's probably like 5 things I could do today so that tomorrow morning is slightly better than this morning was, at least I'm not falling behind. And those will usually be, it's like having to eat a toad in the morning, right? It's like, it's not going to be something you want to do. There'll be things you're trying to avoid. They're snakes, essentially. But if you ask yourself, like you're asking someone, which I think is a form of prayer, if you ask yourself, instead of telling yourself, you know, what is it that I could do to set things more right today that I would actually do? It's usually some small thing, because you're not that disciplined, you know. Then you can go do it. And then you put the world together a little more when you do that. And that spreads out. But you also construct yourself into something that's better able to call order forth from chaos. And that makes you just incrementally stronger. And then the next day, you can maybe take on a slightly larger task. And like, you get the benefit of compound interest if you do that. It's a tremendously powerful technique. And I think if you do that, at some point, instead of just having to fix things up that are not good, you'll start to get a glimmer of the positive things that you could do, you know, the positive things that you could do that would actually constitute a vision. And that's what I would recommend.
Thank you.
All right. Good night.